Please be seated. I stand this morning to welcome all of us to this funeral mass as a sign of our farewell and last respect to Michael, whom the Lord has called back to himself. I welcome in a special way the members of his family. I welcome Bernadette, Stephen, Robert, and David. I welcome Brian, Geraldine, and Margaret. I welcome Peter and Rosemary. And in a special way too, we welcome Anastasia and James, the grandchildren of Michael, and their mother, Peter, who are joining this funeral ceremony online from Australia. I welcome everyone who has come this morning to commiserate with the family of Michael and to pray with them in this holy mass. May the Lord look upon our collective act of devotedness to the faith and open the doors of paradise to Michael through Christ our Lord. Before we begin the Holy Mass, Michael was a man of deep faith and a lover of the Holy Bible, so we now place the Holy Bible on his remain before we continue the Mass. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. The Lord be with you. To prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries worthily, let us now acknowledge our sins and ask God for pardon and for mercy. You were sent to heal the contrite of heart. Lord, have mercy. You came to call sinners to repentance. Christ, have mercy. You intercede for us at the right hand of the Father. Lord, have mercy. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to life everlasting. We remember today also to pray for John Rush and Margaret Fitzsimon, who died recently. Let us pray. Listen kindly to our prayers, O Lord. As our faith in your Son raised from the dead is deepened, may our hope of resurrection for your departed servant, Michael, also find new strength. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. We shall now listen to the readings, and I invite Fiona to take the first reading.
A reading from the book of Ecclesiastes. For everything there is a season, and a time for every matter under heaven, a time to be born and a time to die, a time to plant and a time to pluck up what is planted, a time to heal and a time to build up, a time to weep and a time to laugh, a time to mourn and a time to dance, a time to throw away the stones and a time to gather stones together, a time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing, a time to seek and a time to lose, a time to keep and a time to throw, a time to tear and a time to sow, a time to keep silence and a time to speak, a time for love and a time for peace. The word of the Lord.
I now invite Amy to take the second reading.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. When we were baptized in Christ Jesus, we were baptized in his death. In other words, when we were baptized, we went into the tomb with him and joined him in death, so that as Christ was raised from the dead by the Father's glory, we too might live a new life. But we believe that having died with Christ, we shall return to life with him. Christ, as we know, having been raised from the dead, will never die again. Death has no more power over him anymore. The word of the Lord.
The Lord be with you. Proclamation of the Holy Gospel according to Matthew. Jesus said to his disciples, "When the Son of Man comes in his glory, escorted by all the angels, then he will take his seat on his throne of glory. All the nations will be assembled before him, and he will separate men one from another, as a shepherd separates goats from sheep. He will place the sheep on his right hand and the goats on his left. Then the king will say to those on his right hand, 'Come, you whom my Father has blessed, take for your heritage the kingdom prepared for you since the foundation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me drink. I was a stranger, and you made me welcome. Naked, and you clothed me. Sick, and you visited me. In prison, and you came to see me.' Then the virtuous will say to him in reply, 'Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you drink? When did we see you a stranger and make you welcome, naked and clothe you, sick or in prison and go to see you?' And the king will answer, 'I tell you solemnly, insofar as you did this to one of the least of these brothers of mine, you did it to me.'" The Gospel of the Lord. May we please be seated. A true life story was shared with me some time ago about a man in Africa who had many wives and many children. He was greatly feared by those around him because of his way of life. So one of the many sons went to him, summoned the courage, and said to him one day, "Dad, you are aging, and I'm becoming scared. Because when you die, I wouldn't be comfortable to say things about you that are untrue." So in essence, he was telling his dad to change his ways and live well with people, so that on the day of his funeral, when he is called up to say something about his dad, people will be nodding in affirmation rather than thinking he is lying because the dad wasn't living well. When I read about Michael and I was told about him before this funeral, I said to myself, this would be the easiest homily to give because the life of Michael has spoken for itself. The first point of call was he was a man of deep faith and a lover of the Holy Scripture. Where else do we turn to as a follower, as followers of Jesus, if not to the manual he has left for us? A friend of mine once said that the Bible is the basic instructions we receive before leaving this earth. So the B, basic, the I, instruction. The next B is before, then the L is living, and the last E is the earth. And if we go into the secular world, when we go to obtain some items from the IT world, in order to be able to operate them well, we look to the manual. And because we are God's creatures, and the mind of God is revealed to us in the Holy Scripture, the Scripture becomes a manual for us if we must live in accord with God's plans and designs for us while we walk the surface of the earth. And if you find someone who loves the Scripture, then that someone must be one who is heavenly minded. Because in the Scripture, you have a revelation of the God whom you hope to meet someday when you exit this world. The first reading for Michael's funeral mass is a very common one we know from the book of Ecclesiastes that talks about the various times and seasons under heaven. A time for this, a time for that, a time to be born, a time to die. But often I tell myself that God is the major of all times, and God is love. And if God, who is the major of all time, is love, it means that the best use of time is to love. And if we are able to invest our time loving others and loving God and loving ourselves, then we have lived well. In Michael, we find a life that he's lived for others. Michael is dying at the age of 65, I'm told. He's much younger than so many I have buried in this church. But his life history is a life that impacted others in several ways. And the gospel reading today is also addressing the story of Michael. When I was hungry, you gave me to eat. Thirsty, you gave me something to drink. I was naked, you clothed me. I was a stranger, you made me welcome. Sick and in prison, and you go to see me. What is the work of the Red Cross? How about him traveling overseas in order to make for peace? So when you take all the items of today's gospel, they are already speaking to the reality of the life lived by Michael. It is not the number of years we spend here below that matters. It is the number of lives we are able to touch, the number of people who are able to say, were it not for so and so, my life would have been this positive. Wherever people praise the work of the Red Cross, Michael's name is praised because he was one of that group for many years. St. John of the Cross, in one of his reflections on the theme of love, said, in the evening of our lives, we will all be judged by love. Love is a standard. How much are you able to love? How much am I able to love? And to love means to make sacrifice, not for the sake of the self, but for the sake of others and for the common good. At every funeral, we do not speak to the one who is dead. We speak to ourselves, because oftentimes we tend not to think about the end of us until someone's end arrives. So when someone dies, we remember that there is death and there is an end to human life. So may we learn from the example of Michael, the good life he lived, the community life he showcased. He was on the team of the school, St. Thomas, for so many years, and he was committed to that even until his demise. May we live life that outlives our physical existence, and that can only be possible if we live it for others. May the soul of Michael and the souls of all the faithful departed, through the mercy of God, rest in peace. Amen. We shall now rise to take the prayers of the faithful, and those to lead us are Deborah, Geraldine, Jenny, Christine, and Molly.
Now that Michael has come to the end of his earthly journey, may Christ give him a place at the banquet of the kingdom of heaven. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
Let us pray in thanksgiving for those who tended to Michael during his illness, the doctors, nurses, medical staff in the oncology unit of Tala Hospital. Lord, we thank you for the gifts you've given them and ask you to bless them. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
O God, you promised eternal life to all who follow your way. Raise up all who have died. We pray especially for Michael in gratitude for his life in family and those who came in contact. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
We pray for Michael, who leaves us in death, that God will bring him safely home and share him with the joys of the kingdom of light, happiness, and peace. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
As we reflect on the contribution of Michael to his family, friends, and the wider community, let us all remember him with affection. May we strive for perfection in the service of Christ, his church, and our community. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us. As we continue to intercede for the peaceful repose of Michael Cummins, and for God's comfort and consolation on his family, let us now in silence and add our own private intentions. God of love and mercy, you never turn away anyone you call to yourself. Listen to our prayers, our praises and petitions this day, and open the gates of paradise to your servant, Michael, through Christ our Lord. May we please be seated. Sisters and brothers, that my sacrifice and yours be acceptable to God the Father Almighty. Amen. Look favorably on our offerings, O Lord, so that your departed servant Michael may be taken up into glory with your Son, in whose great mystery of love we are all united, through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. In him the hope of blessed resurrection has dawned, that those saddened by the certainty of dying might be consoled by the promise of immortality to come. Indeed, for your faithful Lord, life is changed, not ended. When this earthly dwelling turns to dust, an eternal dwelling is made ready for them in heaven. And so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory, as without end we acclaim. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. You are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dew fall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more, giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly, we pray that partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, and Demos, our Bishop, and all the clergy. Remember your servant, Michael, whom you've called from this world to your soul. Grant that he who was united with your son in a death like his may also be one with him in his resurrection. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face, have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him, with him, and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, Almighty Father, forever and ever. Amen. At the Savior's command and formed by divine teaching, let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress. So await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Lamb of God. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, grant us peace. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, my soul shall be healed. I am the resurrection and the life, says the Lord. Whoever believes in me, even though he dies, will live. Hallelujah. Let us pray. Grant, we pray, O Lord, that your servant Michael, for whom we have celebrated this Paschal sacrament, may pass over to our dwelling place of light and of peace through Christ our Lord. Before we go into the rite of final commendation, I now invite David to say some words.
First of all, I'd like to thank everybody coming here today. Family and friends, you're all welcome. A special thanks for all the people who travelled today. Also, a big thank you for Father Pius for doing a lovely mass for my dad. Just a short story about my dad. He was a hard-working, caring, loving, and always there for his family and friends. My dad spent 25 years in the army, which he met a lot of great people, some of which are here today to pay their respect. I know I'll be happy to see you all here. A special thank you to the Air Corps itself to make this day so special. I want to say a massive thank you to Sergeant Major Paul Jew, who has been so helpful, extremely helpful the past few days for us. My dad then decided to go into the taxi business, which he spent a good few years in. Doing that, leaving most mornings at 4 a.m. and coming home at 6 p.m., I was supporting our family. In between the taxiing, he had his own business and teaching people how to drive. I know a good few people who he passed, so thank God for that. My dad did a lot of voluntary work, such as the Red Cross, helping out in the credit union as a chairman. So, like you know, we like to keep busy. We like to thank all the neighbours in Woodview for all your support over the few years. All our family really appreciate it, and we'll never forget it. Also, a massive thank you to Oncology Ward and Tala Hospital, who looked after my dad. My dad was an amazing dad. Steve, Rob, and I are so proud to call him my dad, and he taught so much. My dad was also a brilliant raw dad to Anastasia and James. I know we loved them very much. Now onto the love of his life, my man. There are no words to describe the love they have for each other. They're soulmates. He loved traveling and spending time with him every single day. The love my dad had for his family was like no other, and it's something I love to have for the rest of my life, for my wife and my family. Rest in peace, Dad. We all love you.
Thank you very much, David, for the beautiful and lovely words about your dad. There is no doubt that he is now at peace and at rest in God. May that be your source of comfort and consolation. And may that also be a testimony to you of the way to happiness and to good living. We now go into the rite of final commendation. Before we go our separate ways, let us take leave of our brother Michael. May our farewell express our affection for him. May it ease our sadness and strengthen our hope. One day we shall joyfully greet Michael again, when the love of Christ, which conquers all things, destroys even death itself. Our response is, receive his soul and present him to God the Most High. Saints of God, come to his aid. Hasten to meet him, angels of the Lord. Receive his soul and present him to God the Most High. May Christ, who called you, take you to himself. May angels lead you to the bosom of Abraham. Receive his soul and present him to God the Most High. Eternal rest grant unto Michael, O Lord, and let perpetual light shine upon him. Receive his soul and present him to God the Most High. Into your hands, Father of mercies, we commend our brother Michael, in the sure and certain hope that together with all who have died in Christ, he will rise with him on the last day. We give you thanks for the blessings which you bestowed upon Michael in this life. They are signs to us of your goodness and of our fellowship with the saints in Christ. Merciful Lord, turn to us all and listen to our prayers. Open the gates of paradise to your servants and help us who remain to comfort one another with assurances of faith, until we all meet in Christ and we are with you and with Michael forever. Amen. In peace, let us now take Michael to his place of rest.